Good morning, students. I welcome you all to this VTU e-Shikshana program on microwave and antenna. So today we'll be seeing module 3, lecture 3, which is about parallel strip lines. So these are the contents. So basically, in this session, you are going to learn about the construction of a parallel strip line. How do you model this parallel strip line using the transmission line model? Then you are going to derive an empirical expression for the propagation constant gamma and the attenuation constant, and also you will be doing some numerical problems on the topic. So learning objectives, basically here students will be able to learn the construction of a parallel strip line, determine the fundamental line parameters and express them in terms of the geometry of the line, derive an empirical expression for the characteristic impedance and the propagation constant, and you are going to do some numerical problems on the above topic as well using the formulas. So introduction. So a parallel strip line is basically a microstrip line, I can say, which is going to be bidirectional in nature. That means you have one microstrip line here, other microstrip line here, but there is a difference here. Okay, there is a conductor also on top, there is a conductor also on the at the bottom of the there is a conductor. When two conductors, it is basically composed of two perfectly conducting parallel strips, which are going to be separated by a perfect directrix slab of uniform thickness W. Okay, so this is the parallel strip line. So this thickness is W, and directrix substrate is having a directrix constant of epsilon D and permeability equal to mu D. Okay, so we are assuming that this is going to be placed along the xz plane, and this is your y axis. So W represents the plate width, D represents the distance of separation between the two plates, and epsilon RD represents the relative directrix constant of the slab. Okay, so basically a parallel strip line is similar to a two wire conductor or two conductor transmission line. It supports quasi TEM wave mode of propagation. It's a very important thing. As I have told you, electric field lines will be partially in the air and partially in the substrate. So the partially they will be trapped inside the substrate. This gives rise to what is known as the quasi TEM wave mode of propagation, and the fringing capacitance can be neglected provided the strip width is far far greater than the distance of separation. So as I have told you, fringing capacitance is the capacitance which results because of the bending of the electric field lines near the edges. So now what happens is there are two conductors. Okay, when there are two conductors, there is a possibility that some electric field lines will get bent near the conductor surface and get attracted towards the ground plane. Let us say this is one parallel strip line and there is another parallel strip line here. Okay, and the space between the two conductors is going to be filled with a dielectric. Okay, this is your conducting surface. This is again another conducting surface. So this is your dielectric substrate. Our permittivity epsilon RD. This is conductor one, so there will be electric field lines, okay, which will be bent near the edges and attracted towards the other conductor. So these are known as the fringing field lines. Okay, there will be fringing field lines both on the left side as well as on the right side. Okay, and that results in a capacitance, change in the capacitance, and that can be neglected if the width is far far greater than the distance of separation. That means if you keep a larger width compared to the distance of separation, you can neglect the width. So this is the equivalent model of a parallel strip line, a parallel distributed when two conductors are separated by a dielectric, that can be modeled as a two wire transmission line. Okay, then this is your resistance and inductance R delta X, L delta X, and this is your G delta X, C delta X, which is your conductance and the capacitance. So this is for a differential length delta X. Okay, so likewise you have multiple such sections of R delta X, L delta X, G delta X, and C delta X. Basically, as I can say, because of the length of the conductor, okay, the length of the conductor can be modeled as resistance in series with inductance, and because the two conductors are separated by a dielectric, so when current flows on the top of the conductor, there will be a magnetic field. That magnetic field is going to induce a voltage in the neighboring conductor. Okay, so due to this, what happens is there is a conductance between conductor 1 and conductor 2, which we are going to call it as G delta S, and because there are two conductors separated by a dielectric, you get what is known as the capacitance. So this is how you are going to model this parallel strip line, okay, with series arm representing the inductance and the surface resistance, and the shunt arm representing the conductance and the capacitance. Now the series inductance. So series inductance is given by L, which is equal to mu C into D by W. So this is normally expressed in Henry's per meter, where mu C is the permeability of the conducting material, D represents the distance of separation between the two conducting plates, and W represents the width of the conducting plates. So basically, as I can see here, the width is going to contribute, the inductance is inversely proportional to the width and is directly proportional to the distance of separation between the two conductors. So larger distance of separation or larger separation between the two plates gives rise to a larger inductance value. Okay, and because of the two conductors separated by a dielectric, okay, there is a capacitance between the two plates. That capacitance is given by epsilon D into W by D, where W represents the width of the conducting strip, D represents the distance of separation between the two conductors. So capacitance is expressed in farad per meter, and epsilon D is the permittivity of the substrate, which we are going to call it as dielectric constant of the substrate. Next is, there is a surface resistance. So because there is a conducting surface here and another conducting surface here, so basically there is a resistance associated with the surface of the conductor, which we are going to call it as R. R is equal to normally 2RS by W, where RS is the surface resistance, which we already seen. Surface resistance is given by 2 by W into square root of pi F into mu by sigma C. Okay, where W is the width of the conducting strip, F represents the operating frequency, mu C represents the permeability of the conducting strip, sigma C represents the conductivity of the strip. Normally the strip is made up of copper, then conductivity will be equal to 5.8 into 10 power 7. Shunt conductance, as I've told you, there will be a conduction, or I can say there will be a conductance effect between the first conductor and the second conductor, because current flowing in the top conductor is going to produce a magnetic field, which is in turn going to induce a voltage, so that there is a conduction between the wire 1 and the wire 2, or parallel strip 1 and the parallel strip 2, which is at the ground plane and the top. So that is given by this factor sigma D into W by D, where sigma D represents the conductivity of the dielectric material, W represents the width of the conducting surface, and D represents the distance of separation between the two plates. And again, important thing is characteristic impedance. Characteristic impedance is given by root of L by C. As I've already told, Z naught is equal to actually the ratio of the square root of series arm impedance to the shunt arm impedance. Actually, it is equal to R plus j omega L divided by G plus j omega C. So approximately, when you apply the high frequency condition, then Z naught approximately becomes equal to root of L by C. So L is the inductance, which is given by mu C into D by W. C is the capacitance, which is equal to epsilon D into W by D, which is expressed in farad per meter. Substitute these values in the expression for equation 6. We get Z naught as equal to square root of mu C into D by W into D divided by epsilon D into W. So again, D by W can take it outside. Okay, because D square by W square, if you take it under square root, it will be D by W into root of mu C by epsilon D. Mu C can be written as mu naught into mu R. Epsilon D can be written as epsilon naught into epsilon R D. Then the characteristic impedance becomes equal to D by W into root of mu naught into mu R divided by epsilon naught into epsilon R D. Again, epsilon naught you can take it as 8.85 into 10 power minus 12, and mu naught as 4.5 into 10 power minus 7. So root of mu naught by epsilon naught is going to give you 125. Substitute this value. So Z naught finally becomes equal to 125 into D by W into root of mu R by root epsilon R D. Normally mu R will be equal to 1. So Z naught value will be 125 into D by W into root epsilon R D. So this root epsilon rd is in the denominator. So Z naught, the characteristic impedance, is directly proportional to the distance of separation between the two plates, and it is inversely proportional to the width and the square root of the relative permittivity. Next is characteristic impedance. So now again we are trying to simplify this further. Okay, so Z naught is equal to, again finally when you simplify this, it is D by W into root of ud by epsilon d. This is 377 by root epsilon rd into D by W. And for a lossy parallel strip line, at higher microwave frequency, omega L is far far greater than R and omega C is far far greater than G. In that case, what happens is Z naught, as I told you, it is simply equal to root of L by C. If we apply this particular approximation to this particular formula for Z naught, you get Z naught as equal to 377 by root epsilon RD into D by W. That means to say that the characteristic impedance is a function of the distance of separation and the width of the conducting strip. So this relationship holds good as long as W is far far greater than D. That means the width of the conducting strip is far far greater than the distance of separation. Phase velocity. So phase velocity is another important factor. So whenever the electromagnetic wave travels along a parallel strip line, you see that there is a change in the phase, and it travels with certain velocity, which we call it as phase velocity. Definitely its velocity will be different. Okay, the phase velocity is given by omega by beta. Okay, beta is equal to omega root LC. Okay, that is nothing but your phase constant, omega root LC. So then omega by omega root LC will be 1 by root LC. Again, L and C you can substitute for L, and you can substitute for C. You get the VPI is equal to 1 by root of mu D into epsilon D. So I told you L is equal to what? What is the value of L? L is equal to mu C into D by W. Mu C into D by W. And C is equal to epsilon D into W by D. So when you substitute these two conditions, mu C into D by W into epsilon D into W by D, so it will be mu D into epsilon D. So C by root epsilon R D, this is what you are going to get, because mu D can be written as mu naught into mu R, epsilon naught into epsilon R. So mu D can be written as mu naught into mu R D. Okay. Mu naught into and mu R D I can write, no problem. And epsilon D is equal to epsilon naught into epsilon R D. So in that case, what happens is C is equal to 1 by root of mu naught into epsilon naught. You know already this fact, this equation. Epsilon naught. Okay. So in place of this, we are going to substitute as velocity applied. So finally, what remains in the denominator is mu R D into epsilon R D. So again, mu R D is equal to 1. So this is finally the equation boils down to C by root epsilon R D. So in other words, the velocity of the phase velocity of a wave in a parallel strip line will be always less than the velocity of light, because normally velocity of light is the speed with which the electromagnetic waves are going to travel. So this will be, this relationship holds good as long as the wave travels in three space. But once they enter into the dielectric, the velocity gets retarded by 1 by root epsilon R D. Next is propagation constant. So propagation constant is another important parameter. So propagation constant is defined as the product of root of ZY. It is always equal to root of square root of Z into Y, where Z represents the series arm impedance and Y represents the shunt arm admittance. Okay, this is Z into Y always. Okay, Z is the series arm impedance. So series, you have R plus J omega L, and shunt admittance is given by G plus J omega C. So gamma is equal to root ZY, root of R plus J omega L into G plus J omega C. So again, after, if you try to simplify this, we will see how to simplify this. Approximately, it is given by half into R into root of C by L plus G into root of L by C plus J omega root LC. This is what is the expression for gamma you are going to get. Now we will see how to simplify this gamma in the next section. Okay. So gamma is given by root of R plus J omega L into G plus J omega C. You can take J omega L common. Then it will be 1 plus R by J omega L. Here you can again take J omega C as common. It will be 1 plus G by J omega C. Again, what you can do is J omega L into G omega C will be root of J omega whole square into LC. So J omega whole square gets cancelled with square root. So you have root J omega root LC into 1 plus R by J omega L whole power half into 1 plus G by J omega C whole power half. So once you get this, so it will be J omega root LC into 1 plus R by 2 J omega L into 1 plus G by 2 J omega C. This will be J omega root LC into 1 plus G by 2 G omega C plus R by 2 G omega L minus RG divided by 4 omega square LC. Okay, so this is what you are going to get. At higher frequency, omega becomes very high. So 1 by omega square will be very low. So this term can be neglected. So it will be finally g omega root LC plus j omega root LC into g by 2 j omega C plus j omega root LC into r by 2 j omega L. So finally what happens is we'll get j omega root LC plus root LC into g by 2 C can be written as root C in plus root LC into r by 2 L. Again this L can be written as root L into root L. One root L gets cancelled with this root L. Again here also one root C gets cancelled with this root C. So when you try to simplify this, so finally you are going to get half into r into root of C by L plus g into root of L by C plus j omega root LC. So this is what you are going to get finally. So this can be represented as alpha plus j beta, because it's made up of attenuation constant as well as base constant. So equate real part of gamma with real to real and imaginary to imaginary, you get alpha is equal to half into r into root of C by L plus g into root of L by C. Beta is equal to omega root LC. So again, this is your attenuation constant, which is expressed in apers per meter, and beta is the phase constant, which is g omega root LC, which is expressed in radians per meter. So again, this attenuation constant can be further divided into two types. One is alpha C and alpha T, just similar to your microstrip transmission line. So parallel strip line is almost similar. So in that case, what we can do is alpha C represents the attenuation constant due to conductor loss, and alpha T represents the attenuation constant due to dielectric loss. So dielectric loss is given by alpha T. So alpha C is equal to half into R into root of C by L normally, and alpha T is equal to G into root of L by C. Okay, so this takes place inside the dielectric. L is the inductance, C is the capacitance, G is the conductance. So alpha C depends on R, C and L, and alpha T represents on depends on G, L and C. So substitute the value of L and C, as L is equal to mu C into D by W, C is equal to epsilon D into W by D, and R is equal to 2 RS by W, where RS is the surface resistance. So surface resistance can be written as 2 by W into square root of pi F into mu C by sigma C. This is the expression for surface resistance. Substitute all these values in the expression for alpha C, you get alpha C as half into R into root of C by L. Substitute that, you get alpha C as equal to half into R into root of epsilon D into W by D into W divided by mu C into D. So finally, R can be written as 2 RS by W here. So this can be represented as 2 RS by W, where RS is the surface resistance, W is the width of the strip. And again, if you further simplify, so you can write this as half into 2 by W into RS can be written as square root of pi F into mu C by sigma C. Okay, and again this parameter remains the same, mu epsilon D into W by D into W divided by mu C into D. So finally, again try to simplify this, you are going to get 1 by D into square root of pi F by sigma C into root of epsilon D by 1 into 1 into 1. That means we can assume that mu C is equal to 1. Okay, so epsilon D will be there here, and pi F, again mu C is equal to 1, so that's why I have not written anything here, so it is 1. So sigma C will be the conductivity of the conducting material, and D represents the distance of separation. So again, finally it boils down to 1 by D into root of pi F into epsilon D by sigma C. This is the value of alpha C. Again, you can substitute the value of L, C and G in the expression for alpha D. So alpha D, you know already it is given by half into G into root of L by C. Substitute G as equal to sigma D into W by D, L as equal to mu C into D by W, C as epsilon D into W by D. Again, if you try to simplify this, you are going to get alpha D as half into G into square root of mu C into D divided by W into epsilon D into W. So further simplification, you get alpha D as equal to half into, this is sigma D into W by D, this is the value of G. Okay, which I think you all know, G value is given by this parameter, sigma D into W by D, substitute the value of G here. Into this will be D by W, because this is D square, this is W into W. So D square by W square is D by, if you take outside the square root, it will be D by W. Finally, what remains will be root of mu C by epsilon D. So this is what will be remaining. So this is your sigma D into W by D. So again, you try to simplify this further. So alpha D comes out to be equal to half into sigma D, half into sigma D into root of mu C divided by epsilon D. Again, mu C is equal to mu naught into mu R, epsilon D is equal to epsilon naught into epsilon R D. Substitute these values, you get alpha D is equal to half into sigma D into mu root of mu naught mu R divided by epsilon naught into epsilon R D. So again, you substitute for root of mu naught by epsilon naught as 120 pi. where mu naught is 4.0 to 10 power minus 7 Henry per meter, epsilon naught is 8.85 to 10 power minus 12 Farad per meter, and we are assuming a non-magnetic material. Then in that case, mu r value will be equal to 1. Then alpha d is given by half into sigma d into 120 pi into root of mu r by epsilon naught. This is what you are going to get. So again, further you try to simplify this. So alpha d will be equal to 60 pi sigma d into root of 1 by epsilon naught d. Again, multiply 60 into pi, it will be 188.5 into sigma d into root of 1 by epsilon naught d. So this is the final expression that you are going to get after simplification for alpha d. So alpha d is the attenuation constant due to dielectric losses. It depends on the conductivity of the dielectric and also the relative permittivity of the dielectric. Now let us try to do some problem. A lossless parallel strip line has a conducting strip of width W, the substrate dielectric separating the two conducting strips has a relative dielectric constant of 6 and thickness of the substrate is D is equal to 4 mm. Determine the following. The required width W of the conducting strip in order to have a characteristic impedance of 50 ohm, the strip line capacitance, the strip line inductance and the base velocity of the wave in a parallel strip line. So these are the 4 points that has been asked for you. So first solution, the width of the conducting strip is given by this formula. Okay, 377 by root epsilon rd into d by w. So substitute the value of d. Epsilon rd is given as 6. Okay, d is equal to 4 into 10 power minus 3 meters. Okay, and z naught is equal to 50 ohm. So if you substitute, you'll get 12.31 into 10 power minus 3. Okay, this is your inductance. The capacitance is given by epsilon d into w by d. Okay, epsilon d is nothing but your epsilon naught into epsilon r. Epsilon naught is 8.85 into 10 power minus 12. Epsilon r is 6 into w is 12.31 into 10 power minus 3 divided by d is 4 into 10 power minus 3. So this is actually 10 power minus 3. So if you simplify this, you will get capacitance as equal to 163.50 picofarad per meter. Finally, you have inductance L. Inductance strip line inductance is given by L, which is equal to mu C into D by W. Mu C is nothing but mu naught into mu R. Mu naught is equal to 4.0 to 10 power minus 7. Mu R is equal to 1 and D is 4 millimeter or 4 into 10 power minus 3 meters divided by width. W is nothing but 12.31 into 10 power minus 3 meters. Substitute these values here. On simplification, you get L as equal to 0.41 micro henries per meter. The phase velocity is equal to C by root epsilon RD. What is C? C represents the velocity of light. As I have told, it is always equal to 3 into 10 power 8 divided by root epsilon rt, which is equal to root 6. The phase velocity comes out to be equal to 1.22 into 10 power 8 meter per second. The summary. So to summarize the concepts, so in today's class we discussed about what is a parallel strip line. A parallel strip line consists of two conducting strips which are going to be separated by a dielectric. The strips have got the same value of the width W, and D represents the distance of separation between the two conductors. Normally a dielectric is going to be filling the space between the two conductors. So the equivalent circuit of the parallel strip line is equivalent to a two wire transmission line. So because of the conducting strip on the top and the bottom, you have the series resistance and the shunt series inductance, which is going to be called as the series arm, which has got R delta X, L delta X. Because of the separation between the two conductors, you have what is known as the conductance and the capacitance. So the conductance is due to the mutual conduction between the first line and the second line. Because when current flows on the first line, magnetic field is going to be produced that is going to result in a conduction of the that will result in a current flowing in the second conductor. That means there is a conduction, and because there are two conducting plates separated by a dielectric, it also behaves as a capacitance. So the performance of a parallel strip line depends on all these four parameters. So normally there are the inductance and the capacitance, the conductance and the resistance. Okay, you have resistance, inductance, conductance and capacitance. So we derived an empirical expression for resistance, okay, which is equal to R, which is equal to 2RS by W, where RS is equal to square root of pi F into mu by sigma, which is the surface resistance. Sigma represents the conductivity. Okay, then we derived an empirical expression for L. L is equal to mu C into D by W, where D represents the distance of separation between the two conductors and W represents the width of the conductor. Okay, then you have G. G is given by sigma d into W by D, where sigma d is the conductivity of the dielectric, W is the width of the parallel strip, and D is the separation distance. And C is given by, C is the equivalent capacitance because of the two conductors separated by dielectric. And again, it is given by epsilon d into W by D. Okay, where epsilon d is the permittivity of the dielectric, w is the width of the strip, and d is the distance of separation, then we try to derive an empirical expression for propagation constant and characteristic impedance. So characteristic impedance is approximately given by root of L by C, and propagation constant is given by root of Z into Y, or root of R plus j omega L into G plus j omega C. When you try to simplify this, so you are going to get gamma is equal to half into R into root of C by L plus G into root of L by C plus j omega root L C. So again, that can be decomposed as alpha C plus alpha D. So alpha C represents the attenuation constant taking place on the surface of the conductor. Alpha D represents the attenuation constant taking place inside the dielectric. So alpha C can be written as half into R into root of C by L, which takes into account the resistance of the strip, and the conductance is given by half into G into root of C by L, G into root of L by C. Okay, where L represents the inductance, C represents the capacitance. Okay, G represents the conductance. Then we saw the beta is the phase constant. Phase constant is given by the imaginary part, which is omega root LC, and phase velocity is given by omega by beta, isn't it? So omega by omega root LC will be your phase constant, which is 1 by root LC. Okay, then we try to express these values in terms of, we substituted the values in terms of the parameters of the line for L and C. Then we could get a more simplified expression for this phase velocity and the fundamental parameters. Then also we did some problems on the parallel strip lines. And finally, I think we have concluded our session. So in the next class, we'll be looking into the coplanar strip lines and the shielded strip lines. So shielded strip lines are those lines wherein the entire strip is going to be sealed. That means the copper conducting strip. It's a microstrip line which is going to be shielded with a dielectric. The dielectric will be covering the entire conductor, rectangular conductor. Okay, that's a shielded strip line. So we will try to model that shielded strip line. Again, we will try to derive some more empirical expressions for that. So till then, thank you for your patient listening.